Harper Audio presents Millions by Frank Cottrell Boyce, read by Simon Jones. One. If Anthony was telling this story, he'd start with the money. It always comes down to money, he says, so you might as well start there. He'd probably put, once upon a time, there were 229,370 little pounds sterling, and go on until he got to, and they all lived happily ever after, in an high-interest bank account. But he's not telling this story. I am. Personally, I like to start with the patron saint of whatever it is. For instance, when we had to write about Moving House for Literacy Hour, I put, Moving House, by Damian Cunningham, 4th grade. We have just moved house to 7 Cromarty Close. The patron saint of moving house is St. Anne, 1st century. She was the mother of Our Lady. Our Lady did not die, but floated up into heaven while still fairly young. St. Anne was upset. To cheer her up, 4 angels picked up her house and took it to the seaside in Italy, where it can be seen to this day. You can pray to St. Anne for help with moving house. She will watch over you, but not do actual removals. Anne is also the patron saint of miners, horse riding, cabinet makers, and the city of Norwich. While alive, she performed many wonders. The patron saint of this story is St. Francis of Assisi, 1181 to 1226, because it all sort of started with a robbery, and the first saintish thing he ever did was a robbery. He stole some cloth from his father and gave it to the poor. There is a patron saint of actual robbers, Dismas, 1st century, but I'm not an actual robber. I was only trying to be good. It was our first day at Great Ditton Primary School. The sign outside says, Great Ditton Primary, creating excellence for a new community. See that, said Dad, as he handed us our lunches and left us at the gates. Good isn't good enough here. Excellence, that's what they're after. My instruction for the day is, be excellent. The instructions for supper I'll leave on the fridge door. One thing about me is that I always really try to do whatever Dad tells me. It's not that I think he'll go off and leave us if we're a problem, but why take a risk? So I was excellent first lesson. Mr. Quinn was doing People We Admire for Art Hour. A huge boy with a freckly neck nominated Sir Alex Ferguson and listed all the football trophies United had won under his stewardship. A boy called Jake said players were more important than managers and nominated Wayne Rooney for individual flair. Mr. Quinn was looking around the room. To be educational about it, football was not taking him where he wanted to go. I put my hand up. He asked a girl.
Don't know any footballers, sir.
It doesn't have to be a footballer.
Oh, don't know then, sir.
I used my other hand to hoist my hand up higher. Damien, who do you admire? By now, most of the others were into players versus managers. I said, St. Roch, sir. The others stopped talking. Who does he play for?
No one, sir. He's a saint.
The others went back to football. He caught the plague and hid in a wood so he wouldn't infect anyone, and a dog came and fed him every day. Then he started to do miraculous cures and people came to see him, hundreds of people, in his hut in the woods. He was so worried about saying the wrong thing to someone that he didn't say a word for the last 10 years of his life.
We could do with a few like him in this class.
Thank you, Damien.
He's the patron saint of plague, cholera and skin complaints. While alive, he performed many wonders.
Well, you learn something new.
He was looking for someone else now, but I was enjoying being excellent. Catherine of Alexandria, 4th century, came to mind.
They wanted her to marry a king, but she said she was married to Christ. So they tried to crush her on a big wooden wheel, but it shattered into 1,000 splinters, huge, sharp splinters, which flew into the crowd, killing and blinding many bystanders.
That's a bit harsh. Collateral damage, eh? Well, thank you, Damien.
By now, everyone had stopped debating players versus managers. They were all listening to me.
After that, they chopped her head off, which did kill her, but instead of blood, milk came spurting out of her neck. That was one of her wonders.
Thank you, Damien.
She's the patron saint of nurses, fireworks, wheel makers, and the town of Dunstable, Bedfordshire. The Catherine Wheel is named after her. She's a virgin martyr. There are other great virgin martyrs. For instance, Saint Sexburger of Ely, 670 to 700. Everyone started laughing. Everyone always laughs at that name. They probably laughed at it in 670 to 700, too. Sexburger was Queen of Kent. She had four sisters who all became saints. They were called, before I could say Ethelburger and Withburger, Mr. Quinn said, Damian, I did say thank you. He actually said thank you three times. If that doesn't make me excellent, I don't know what does. I was also an artistic inspiration, as nearly all the boys painted pictures of the collateral damage at the execution of St. Catherine. There were a lot of fatal flying splinters and milk spurting out of necks. Jake painted Wayne Rooney, but he was the only one. In the dining hall, a boy on hot lunches came and waggled his burger under my nose and said, "Sexy burger, sexy burger!" All the people round the table laughed. I found this very unenlightening and was about to say so when Anthony came and sat by me and they all stopped. We had ham and tomato sandwiches and two small cans of Pringles. I said, "I've been excellent. What about you?" He whispered, "You are making yourself conspicuous. You need to blend in more. People are laughing at you." "I don't mind being laughed at. Persecution is good for you. They laughed at Joseph of Coppertino until he learnt to levitate." The huge boy with a freckly neck came and sat down. His belly caught the end of the table and tipped it up. My can of Pringles rolled toward him. He picked it up and opened it. "They're his," said Anthony, pointing at me. "And who are you?" asked Freckleneck. "I'm his big brother." "You're not that big. All Pringles belong to me." A dandruff of crumbs fell from his mouth. "School policy. You can't take his Pringles. He's got no mum." "How can he have no mum? Everyone's got a mum. Even people who've got no dad have got a mum. I'm enjoying these, by the way." "She's dead," said Anthony. Freckleneck stopped crunching and handed my Pringles back. He said his name was Barry. "Nice to meet you, Barry." Anthony offered him his hand to shake. Anthony believed in making friends. "Where do you live?" he asked. "Over the bridge, next to the 24-hour store." "Now that," said Anthony, "is a very sought-after area. Very sought-after. My brother is very, very interested in real estate." On the way to the playground, Anthony said, "Works every time. Tell them your mum's dead and they give you stuff." In the afternoon, for some reason, I decided to do a St. Roch. I forbore all temptation to speak during math hour. Didn't put my hand up, didn't answer a tables question even when pointed at. When Mr. Quinn asked me if I was okay, I was tempted to reply, but I just nodded my head instead. I wasn't contributing to the class, but I was being excellent, in a different, less obvious way. I kept this up all the way home. Dad had left instructions fixed to the fridge door with a magnet. "Dear boys, chicken and asparagus pie. The pie is in the top drawer of the freezer. Put the oven on to 375 degrees. Go and watch countdown. When countdown is over, the oven will be warm enough. Put the pie in. Change your clothes and put your uniforms over the end of your bed. Then put some oven fries in. I will be home before they're cooked. D." I enjoyed being called dear. When Dad came home, we had the pie, followed by five pieces of fruit and a pint of water each to hydrate our livers. When they were completely hydrated, we did our homework and he sat with us. I still didn't say a word, but then the phone rang and I accidentally answered it. I don't know how St. Roch kept it up for 10 years, although admittedly he had it easier living in a time before phones. Anyway, it was Mr. Quinn. My teacher actually rang our actual house. How excellent is that? Later, Dad came and sat on the end of the bed and said, "You're a bit quiet today. Cat got your tongue?" I shook my head. "I heard you were quiet in school, too." I nodded. "Anything you want to tell me?" Shook again. "Right. Well, time for bed." He'd nearly closed the door when the temptation to speak finally overwhelmed me. I said, "What did Mr. Quinn want?" "Well, you know, a chat, really. It was him who was telling me about how quiet you were." "He said thank you to me three times, so I must have been fairly excellent. Did he say I was excellent?" He said, "Yes, he said you were excellent."
He ruffled my hair.
"One of the customers was telling me about this place today. It's called a snowdrome. You can toboggan or have a go at skiing. Fancy it?"
I wasn't sure.
"For being excellent, as a reward?"
"Okay, then."
"Okay. So we'll go straight from school tomorrow, because you're excellent."
The snowdrome was quality completely. It's real snow inside, made of ice crystals from a big blower. They give you a special snowsuit to wear when you're in there. You're not supposed to have two people on a toboggan, but Anthony explained to the man that our mum was dead, and he let us do what we liked. We went down twice two together, once on our bellies and three times backward. In school next morning, everyone was interested to hear all about it. I explained how the ice blower worked, and was giving a demonstration of backward tobogganing when I smashed into Mr. Quinn, who was coming in through the door.
"Watch it, watch it!" he yelled as he dropped all our workbooks.
I helped him pick them up. I saw my own, the one about St. Anne. It had a note stuck inside, which he took out and pocketed as he gave me back the book.
"What do you think you're playing at, lad?"
"The snowdrome, sir. We went. It was good."
He suddenly looked all cheery. He said,
"Well, you could write about that for today's literacy hour, couldn't you? Give an exciting description of all the fun you had. No patron saint of snowdromes, I bet."
Speak Snowdrome by Damian Cunningham, Mr. Quinn's class. Speak Snowdrome is quality. You can skate or toboggan. The patron saint of skating is Lidwina, Virgin Martyr, 1380 to 1433, who was injured in a skating accident and spent the rest of her life in bed. She bore her mortification with forbearance and performed several wonders. For instance, eating nothing but Holy Communion wafers for 7 years. You can read more about her at www.totallysaints.com/lidwina.html.
The truth is, there is always a patron saint. As St. Clare of Assisi, 1194 to 1253, once said to me, "Saints are like TV, they're everywhere. But you need an aerial."
2. Anthony can't believe I've got this far without mentioning European Monetary Union. European Monetary Union by Anthony Cunningham, 5th grade. Money was invented in China in 1100 BC. Before that, Chinese merchants used knives and spades to trade with. These were too heavy to carry, so they used model knives and spades instead. These were made of bronze and were the first coins. Soon every country had its own coins. In Europe alone, there were the sturdy German Deutschmark, the extravagant Italian lira, the stylish French franc, and of course the great British pound. The pound was first invented in 1489 when it was called a sovereign. On December 17th, it will be replaced by the euro. When you put an old pound in the bank, they put it on a special train that takes it to a secret location to be scrapped. Then the train comes back in the morning with new money. So right now, nearly all the money in England is on trains. You should collect your old coins in separate jam jars, one for 5 pence, one for 10, one for 20, and so on. When they're full, take them to the bank to exchange. December 17th is Euro Day, the day we say goodbye to the old pound. Anthony said goodbye to the old pound nearly every day. On the way home from school, he used to run like mad to the middle of the footbridge, then wait there till a train went roaring by beneath us. Then he'd wave and yell till it was out of sight, just like the railway children, shouting, "Goodbye, goodbye, old pounds!" He made it sound like every single £10 note was a personal friend. Sometimes you'd think he was going to cry. "Just think," he'd say, 500-odd years of history, up in smoke." Other times he'd seem quite happy about it. "Just think," he'd say, "come Christmas, we'll be able to spend the same money from Galway to Greece." Every night before we went to bed, the three of us dropped any small coins we had into a big whiskey bottle at the foot of the stairs. On the way to bed, Anthony would nearly weep as he dropped his coins in. On the way to breakfast, he'd stroke the bottle happily and say, "Amazing how fast it mounts up." Personally, I think so what? Money's just a thing and things change. That's what I've found. One minute something's really there, right next to you, and you can cuddle up to it. The next, it just melts away, like a Hershey's kiss.
3.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.